Such an organization, you've been asked to come to this big church to do a special program. And so he was sitting there looking out over the congregation, and the pastor looked over at him and said, "Are you trying to find people that have heard your sermon?" And he said, "No, I'm trying to find those that haven't, because I have preached this so many times." So if I run over things tonight that you've heard before, that's all right. You can't hear it too much. Because when I was in Bible school, the professor said there's three things that you gotta know. You gotta know that you have to learn this. You gotta study it to learn it. And then I'm gonna tell you what you have to learn. So you have to be taught. You know, we can learn by repetition. So tonight, I wanna talk to you a little bit about, if you could choose any sermon from the Bible and hear it live, which one would it be? Those of you that got papers, you can follow along. And I thought of Elijah. What a great sermon he preached. Actually, his greatest one was his prayer. But he said, how long do you go between two opinions? I mean, some you're for God, and then you're for Baal. You're for God, and then you're for Baal. And he got all of his people together, and he told them that they had to repent. And can you imagine telling the whole nation? Can you imagine getting up on TV and telling this country how sorry and no good they are, and they're all going to go to hell if they don't repent? Well, they'd take us out and hang us. But anyway, he told the people, he said, go bring two bullocks in, and then we'll find out. If God be God, we'll serve God. And if Baal be God, we'll serve him. So he got the bullocks, and he told Baal's prophets, you pick the one you want. He didn't want them to think he was doing anything that wasn't right. So he said, you take yours and cut it up and put it on the altar. You dress it and put it on the altar, and I'll take mine. And they put their offering on the, or their sacrifice on the altar, and they prayed and cried and hollered. Now listen, I've heard people holler when they pray. You don't have to holler. God's not deaf, you know? He's not hard of hearing. He don't wear a hearing aid. And they were hollering and screaming and begging for God. Well, I missed the thing there. Elijah told them, the God that answers by fire, that is the God we'll serve. Well, they went on from morning till noon, and nothing happened. And Elijah's laughing at him and said, maybe he's asleep, or maybe he's gone on a journey. Maybe you need to holler a little louder. Maybe he's off in the back room. Maybe he's talking to somebody. Nothing. Well, it was noontime, and it was time for the midday offering for sacrifice for Israel. So Elijah took 12 stones and put them out, and he dug a trench around those 12 stones, and then he dressed his sacrifice and put it on the altar. And he said, go bring me 3 pails of water, or 4 pails of water, I'm sorry, 4 pails of water, and pour it in the trench. And he said it again, go bring me 4 pails of water, pour it in the trench. And he said it again, go bring me 4 pails of water. Well, 3 times 4 is 12. Well, anything you do for God, foundation, traditionally, you do it in 12s. God builds on 12. I mean, the New Jerusalem has 12 gates, it has 12 foundations. It's got the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. So there Elijah was. He had those 12 pails of water in there. And he started to pray. And he said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art God, and that thou hast turned their hearts back again. 63 words he spoke, and a fire fell. And can you imagine? I mean, I've been shouting, standing on my head, and I would imagine that Israel, even though they had been backslid from God, the Bible tells us that God is married to the backslider. Well, that's Israel was the backslider. Christ is our groom. We are the bride of Christ, but where it says God is married to the backslider, that's Israel. So I can well imagine how thrilled they were when they saw that fireball. It didn't just burn up the sacrifice, it lapped up all the water that was around it. And that's what God did. And that was a wonderful sermon. And I thought about Jesus on the Mount, the Beatitudes. And I thought that must have been a marvelous day to sit there and hear him say, blessed. Blessed are the low, the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that mourn. Blessed are the meek. And he goes on for 107 verses. In Matthew 5, 6, and 7, he talks about how we should live. He gives us the attitude that we should have in everyday life. Well, that was a marvelous sermon, no doubt. And then there was Peter on the day of Pentecost. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken unto my words. For these are not drunken, as you suppose, seeing that it be but the third hour of the day. But this is that was spoken of by the prophet Joel. How many hundreds of years have they been waiting for that to come? They went and stayed and tarried until it came. They didn't know what they were waiting for, but that was all right. If God said do it, they did it. Then there's Paul, bless his heart, up on Mars Hill. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ignorantly worship him, declare I unto you. Well, you know, Paul, he took a lot of chances. He got beat up, I forget how many times, but he took 39 stripes. He was thrown in prison. He was left for dead. He was shipwrecked. But he wasn't afraid to preach Jesus. He said, I'm going home with Jesus. I don't care what happens. I don't care what's going on around me. find my favorite of all the sermons in the Bible is the one with the men on the road to Emmaus. And I know that you have read this and you've heard it preached and heard it preached. And that's all right. Every time I read it, I get excited. You know, when I was in elementary school in Cincinnati, Ohio, our teacher used to take us on what they call field trips. I don't know why they called them that. We never did go to the field. We always ran into some building. But she took us to the Cincinnati Art Museum, and they had some beautiful, beautiful pictures. And they had one there that was off the road to Emmaus, and it had the two men walking, taking those big strides, and a man with a hood on, and you couldn't see his face. Well, it tells us, and I'm going to read it to you here, that the men didn't know him. His face was holding to them. God was holding his recognition back. So when I got big enough to read the Bible and read about it, I remember that picture in that. And they wanted $1 million for it. And that has been 60 years ago. So you can imagine what that painting would be like. But Jesus didn't have a hood over his head. They knew him. Well, let's read the scripture. And behold, two of them went that same day to the village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 60 furlongs, which is about 7 miles. And they talked together of all these things that had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that you have one to another, and as you walk and are saying? And one of them, whose name was Cleopas, said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in these days? And he said unto them, what things? I think I just love that. I can just hear him say, well, what things? And they're going on and on and on about what has happened. And they said unto him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty indeed in word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and to have crucified him. But we trusted, notice the past tense here, that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel, and besides all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre. Well, here they are. They wanted Jesus to be alive, and they saw him buried. And they knew that he was in that tomb, and yet here come these silly women saying, he's not there, he's risen. We saw angels that told us that he's alive. Well, there goes the thing against women preachers. Guess who was the first one to preach that Jesus is alive? Well, well, well. Okay, let's get down here. And when they found not his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels which had said he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. Then he said unto them, I can just see him, this big tall Galilean, stomping his foot in that dust and saying, oh, fools and slow of heart, to believe that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and entered into his glory? I can just see them as, you know, you would think, if you spend 3 years with somebody walking up and down the roads every day, seeing them go in and out of the synagogue, you would think that you would know them either by their walk, their gait, but they didn't know him.
He took it, he
It's in Matthew, the little boy with the lunch. Jesus took the bread. He blessed it. He broke it. And he gave it to 5,000 people. And they collected how many baskets? 12. There we go with that 12 again. A solid ground for Jesus' teaching. And then at the Last Supper, he took the bread, he blessed the bread, he broke it, and he gave it to those that were there. Well, we find Moses after they had heard that there was a king, well, there was going to be all these babies killed. There Moses was floating down the Nile in that little basket. And Pharaoh's daughter saw him. And what happened? She took him. And God blessed him. He was blessed mightily. He sat at Pharaoh's table. He was an astronomer. He knew about the stars. He was a builder. But then God broke him. Oh, God broke him. Well, he killed an Egyptian because he still had that ethnic enough to know there was something in him that was not Egyptian. He was a Hebrew. And somehow God showed him, and boy, he got broke. He had to cross the desert, and he found a well where there was women around it, and I believe Jethro, his father's name, father-in-law's name. He was blessed there. He learned more and more about God. And he kept wondering about that mountain up there that had fire on top of it. Well, he went up there after God broke him. He sent him back to Israel to get them. You know, God takes us. He blesses us. And he breaks us. I've been broken many times, thinking I was too good. I prayed too much. I did this for the Lord, and I did that for the Lord. But I got broken. But then he called me to preach. And I didn't want that. So look out, Brother Mark. Oh, boy. You're great. Well, he gave Moses to the Israelites. And you know, a lot of times you wonder why bad things happen to good people. Well, look at Moses. He was good. But Israel would not have been delivered had these things not happened to him. Then there's Joseph. What a sweet child he was. His daddy loved him better than all of them. He had dreams, a little dream. Well, God took him. Then he broke him. His brothers put him down in a pit. And then, well, I believe it was Ishmael's kinfolk that combined took him out of that pit and took him to Egypt and sold him. Well, he got to go to Potiphar's house. There he was broke. He got to go to Potiphar's house, and then Potiphar's wife lied on him. He had to go to prison. Poor Joseph, you wonder. And then there was the one that didn't, I can't remember, it's a baker or a candle man. Anyway, one of them forgot him. But Pharaoh had this dream, and I believe it was the baker. He said, "I know a guy that's in prison that can tell you what that means. He's in touch Then we have Jesus. He was 8 days old. God blessed him. He was taken to the temple, and there he was circumcised, and Anna came out saying that he was the Messiah, and Simeon, he came out and said, I can go to be with the Lord. Now I have seen the Lord's Christ. So, you know, sometimes we can't understand why we're going through the things that we're going through. We're traveling on a sea that's rough and rugged and feels like we're going to sink. But you know, God didn't promise us smooth sailing. He just promised that we'd land safely on the other side. If we will trust in Him as we sail the sea of sin, safely on the other side. Well, God blessed Jesus, and then he broke him. Oh my, did he ever break him. He was beaten. He was spit on. His beard was pulled out. 619 soldiers went by and slapped him open-handedly. They drug his clothes off of him. Brother Green preached on this. Brother Green, I believe it's you, wasn't it? How they beat him. He was broken. But he said, it is finished. Lord, I give you the ghost. He gave up the ghost, and God gave him to us. What better thing can we have than God giving us Jesus to wash our sins away? He don't cover them up. He takes them away. They're in the sea of forgetfulness. Says that they're as far as the east is from the west. I've often wondered why that was. Well, if you go north, soon you'll be going south. But if you go east to west, you're never going to do anything but go east to west, east to west. So our sins are hidden. And God has made a way for us, and every one of us. One of these. We're either being called out, being blessed. We may be going through a broken time, but even though we get zipped as we, God is there to take care of us. Aren't you glad for Jesus? Now, I promised you a surprise.